Holy cats, so freaking pod.
Chapter 15.
Hey, I want to say, this is Cherrydoom, by the way, I want to say at the top here, we're on iTunes now, so she wanted to go find us and then rate us and review us, that would be really cool.
That's news to me.
Sorry, well, I've been putting it on every post,
that's
but
news
anyway.
To me, Chuuurls, who doesn't read the posts. that's weird. I must have just glossed over that because I actually do read the posts.
Hidden in a completely separate post is Chad.
Yes, this is Chad, actually. I'm just a bit sick. I have a much deeper voice. Hello!
It's time for the summary, which I'm going to read to everybody. Everybody and God. Christian comes over to Anastasia's house with a bottle of champagne. Anastasia tries to give the Thomas Hardy books back, but Christian ain't having it. She tries to get him to auction the books and donate the funds to a Darfur charity, then backpedals. The issue is unresolved for now. Then the drinking begins. Christian pours tons of alcohol into Anastasia. They eventually start in on the hard and soft limit discussion, which includes explanations of sex toy and bondage and some sex acts as well, for the possibly ignorant reader, I'm guessing. Christian reveals first that he will try a relationship with Anastasia one night a week, whatever that means, because I think a relationship is a full-time job. He reveals that he will only do this if she accepts her graduation present, which he reveals to be a new Audi two-door compact. And so at first she's mad, but then she's okay with it because Christian was poor once. And then Christian has a mood swing and they fuck. Here's the summary of the sex. Christian pulls her hair and kisses her on the car. They rush into the apartment. He disrobes her and says some stuff about her smell or like her skin or something. No bra, he says. I like that, Miss Steele. He does some nipple tease stuff, denies her orgasm. Then with his Hulk hands, tears her panties off. He commands her to undress him and tells her that she can do what she will with him. She tugs on his pubes to discipline him for moving in response to sexy stimuli. Anastasia gives him oral, then they have PIV sex and both have an orgasm.
How? She was wearing a backless dress. How is she supposed to wear a bra?
Good question. There's some options. I was doing some research because I have an outfit that I need to do that for.
Just put duct tape over it. Don't use duct tape.
No, don't use duct tape.
Just kidding.
They sell all these things called pasties that just stick right on. And then there's also, there's like these weird cup things. They sell them at like Walgreens. You just like...
They're like sticky and like weird looking.
Some are sticky, some are not.
It makes you almost look like you just don't have nipples. Anyway.
Anyways, pet theories.
Pet theories.
Alright.
Let's see, they're going over the contract again. And, quote, he fishes out another copy of my email and the list. Does he wander around with these lists in his pockets? I think there's one in his jacket that I have. There are copies of this contract everywhere. Someone's gonna find the dang things, with the names and everything, and the non-disclosure agreement will be ruined. And I think this might tie into Christian's secret contract fetish. He brings them with him everywhere so that he can get a thrill of them being close to him.
Or it's just like him being obsessed with working this thing out, which is also scary.
True.
Yeah.
Chad?
So I had a theory, and... It's written in the form of several questions. Goddess is Roman goddess? Lust destroyed Pompeii? Anastasia development eternally stunted by occupation of goddess? Christian will free her from this malign influence?
To sum up, what does that mean?
This ties into the goddess watch, so maybe I'll get into it a little later.
That's acceptable.
But basically, it seems like the goddess draws her power from pleasure or lust. And she's about to... do a thing, which we will talk about later. Okay, so please cut that out. That was terrible.
No, I'm not going to cut it out. I'm the second wave of editing, and I'll never listen to you. I had this theory to build on that goddess, Roman goddess thing. I actually had this theory that the goddess was Yahweh, and Anna is his, her, or its prophet. But this falls apart for many, many reasons. the Hebrew god Yahweh and the goddess of Anastasia's vagina really don't have that much in common. Other than that, they have a human that can hear what they're saying, like, however it occurs. I guess Anastasia hears her goddess in her thoughts, whereas Yahweh comes in the quiet moments as a whisper.
You say it's because the goddess is not concerned with justice, but what about the subconscious? She seems to be fairly concerned with justice. In fact, I think she took the form of justice in her scales once.
Hmm, that's interesting, and it's pretty true that you bring this up. But then you would have to say, rather than it being a Hebrew analog or whatever, sorry, allegory, it's actually a Zoroastrian one. Because you see, in Zoroastrianism, there's Ahura Mazda, and then there's something else Mazda, which I forget. But anyway, it boils down to positive thoughts and negative thoughts, and you're always supposed to repel the negative thoughts or spirit. All right, mechanics. Anastasia says, I suck hard. I suck, comma, hard. And I'm sure that for some of you, you are fine with that. I don't like it. I don't think there should be a comma there. So I think it should just be, I suck hard. Like, as in, I suck on the thing hard. But it occurs to me that Eel James probably just didn't want Anastasia to admit that she as a person sucks, not that she was, like, sucking a dick.
I think it would be cool if it was a semicolon. I suck hard.
But then that does make it sound like the other thing, and not about dicks.
Okay.
Wait, doesn't that just make it sound like she sucks while she's hard?
Ooh, yeah, it does. You're right. Well,
whoa.
Which is still funny. With the semicolon, I mean.
Does it sort of maybe sound like that now? I suck, comma, hard?
Like, okay, yeah, I suck. And then her condition is, yeah. That's a good observation, Chadwick.
So if she really wanted to be precise, she should use, like, a fillet.
I fillet robustly. Okay. Quote, I head into the kitchen, nervous. Oh, I head into the kitchen, period. Nervous, comma, butterflies flooding my stomach, comma. It's like having a panther or mountain lion, all unpredictable and predatory, in my living room. It's just like an avalanche of terrible, terrible things.
Oh god, it's like a smorgasbord of crimes. It's horrible.
Oh god, it's like comma things happening, like that's not even really a sentence. And then she also does the all unpredictable and predatory thing. Which is usually when she does the all something and something, it's nouns, all, you know, high heels and tank tops, or, but this one is adjectives, which is a little more how it is supposed to be used, I suppose, but I don't know, it's just weird and I don't like it. I don't like this whole sentence, two sentences. Let's see. And it sort of sounds like the butterflies flooding her stomach is like having a panther or mountain lion in the living room, which I don't know, it just does not follow. It should have been two separate sentences.
Well, speaking of which, it's nervous comma butterflies flooding her stomach. Like, why isn't it nervous butterflies, not nervous with butterflies flooding the stomach? Most of us refer to nervous butterflies.
It's not, I mean, it's she's the one who's nervous, and butterflies are flooding her stomach. They are not nervous. They are just doing their butterfly best.
But when you have that feeling, don't you call it, like, a nervous butterfly feeling?
She doesn't refer to herself.
No, I'm not saying that it's incorrect, because it can be correct. I just think
no,
that
I'm
weird.
No, I'm not saying you're incorrect. I'm just saying it's, like, yeah, let's move on.
So E.L. James in this chapter just abuses ellipses all over the place. It's really, really bad. And she tends to put them, like, in sort of the quote-unquote wrong place, or she breaks up phrases and sentences in weird ways, or, like, in the weirdest possible ways. Here's an example. I'm able to tug down his trousers and his boxers at the same time. Whoa. Freeing him.
I think I remember noticing that.
I'm glad that you brought up this sentence, because it was quite bad, but it wasn't bad in a way that I wanted to, like, start explaining.
She does this in a bunch of other places. Like, she'll break up, oh no, but she goes, oh, no. Or, like, oh, please, comma, something else.
I think there's about 40 ellipses, and the chapter's only 20 pages.
Oh my god. Wait, 40? Is that, like, a...
No, it's less. It's about, like, 16 pages.
No, I mean, is that an approximate number of ellipses? 40?
Yeah.
Yeah, she's terrible about it this chapter. Sort of a return to how she was, like, way back in the single-digit chapters, like, once or twice, but I don't know.
I, too, don't know. Here's the last thing in the notes, and probably for mechanics. He really is a fine specimen of a man. Looking at him is very, very arousing. So that was, he really is a fine specimen of a man, comma. Looking at him is very, comma, very arousing. Look at this shitty sentence. And I believe it's a sentence splice, because it really should have been, he really is a fine specimen of a man, period. Looking at him is very, very arousing. And that would have been fine, but it's just comic crime.
Yep.
This chapter ends with Anna orgasming. I don't know, it's just it's a different way for a chapter to end, I feel.
Yeah, it should have ended on a cliffhanger. Are they going to orgasm?
There's usually some kind of...
Denouement!
There's usually some kind of denouement with, like, alright, she orgasms, and Christian is like, blah, blah, and she's like, blah, blah, and then there's, like, some kind of cliffhanger. So this was a weird way to end it.
Yeah, or, like, she, like, at least full passes out exhausted. No, she just, the first time, she just, like, went to sleep.
Yeah.
And then woke up, and then went to sleep again. And then another time, she, like... Christian left and she cried.
Right, but both those are like a more natural way to...
Yeah. And this one, she's just like, I was in control now, and then I came, and then I was done, and then the next chapter happened.
Yeah, it was definitely really weird.
I think it was probably just broken up incorrectly. My feeling with this chapter was kind of that it was too long. It probably should have been broken up where he's like, I'll do the relationship with you on one condition, and then that's a cliffhanger. You know?
Yeah.
And then you have more space to be flexible with where you want to end it. You, E.L. James, you.
Like, within this sort of chapter where you actually have something that, an event that's big, usually you would have, either you'd end it on a cliffhanger in the middle of the event, which doesn't really work for sex, or you follow, like, a mini-drama structure where you have, like, the climax, and then you have, like, a denouement, as Cheryl said. You have, like, another act following it, or, like, a small section scene to cap it off.
This is the exact same place the chapter ends in the fanfiction that I'm looking at right now, called The Master of the Universe. And what's interesting, sort of, almost, is that chapters are about half as long in the fanfiction.
Yeah, I noticed that.
This chapter is actually chapter 31 rather than chapter 15. So, I mean, it sounds like maybe she just had weird chapter breaks all over the place and then just smashed chapters together when she made the full book.
Yeah, well, I think it was one of the big influences of the editors, I think, because do we have any idea how often she posted the chapters? Did she post them in clusters? Did she post them individually?
No idea.
Because she couldn't, like, with how the chapters are broken up, if she posted them chapter by chapter, she couldn't even sustain, like, 16 pages of writing.
Yeah, I'm really curious about that kind of thing. I don't know if, like, maybe there's... She basically took this... It was very hard to find this fiction because she just took it all off the internet so that she could sell this book.
Yeah.
But I would really like to, like, find out about how it was released, whether she did it all at once or, like, some people do sometimes, whether she wrote it in spurts with, you know, lots of feedback during the process.
I wonder if we have any listeners who, like, read the fan fiction when it came out, and then I would be really curious to talk to them because they'd have some insight on it. I bet it's quite a low probability, but I'm still interested.
This is a really, really bad sentence. It's like the one that Cherrydoom pointed out earlier with Nervous and Butterflies. His finger reaches the back of my halter dress midway down my spine, and hooking his finger beneath the top, he pulls me closer so that I step back against him so that he's flush against my body. Yeah, and that's all one sentence. Like, there's no, she doesn't break it up with punctuation, no semicolons, no dashes. She doesn't break it into two sentences. The last part is really bad.
Yeah. Like, read that again. You need to, listeners, you need to hear how bad that is again.
He pulls me closer so that I step back against him so that he's flush against my body.
So that.
Yep. That last part should be basically entirely rephrased.
Actually, it should be refreshed.
It should be refreshed, particularly so that he's flush part, rather than having that annoying repetition with no pauses there. So it could be rephrased as, like, he pulls me closer so that I step back against him, flush against my, pulling me flush against his body, or there's a number of ways you could do it. It's just,
I actually have a wording complaint here, which I'm not going to save for later because I'm not going to remember it. I didn't like that she said flush against my body. I understand the meaning of it. I understand this is a thing you can say. The fact that she uses flush so much in other situations to mean blushing, it kind of sounds like he's against her back going like, he is flush against my body.
Another thing is that she could, she over-describes here. She goes through the effort of saying, like, she steps back against, she could just condense that into, he pulls me closer so that I'm flush against his body, or, like, he's flush against my back, or something like that, rather than having to just say that, like, I step back in order for that to happen.
Well, how about this? His finger hooks the low back of my halter dress, and he pulls me closer so that my back is against his stomach or something like that. Like, I mean, I didn't even really think about that or write it out, but it could be really a lot easier to phrase.
He hooks his finger beneath the top of my dress, pulling me flush against him. I mean, you could condense that sentence so easily.
But the positioning, it seemed like that was what she struggled with the most to describe, which is that she's facing front and he's also facing
positioning
front.
That important? Like,
maybe.
The positioning would still be apparent.
Oh, maybe it was.
Because she's already facing away from him, because he's behind her, like, feeling up her back.
Oh, okay.
Then so he pulls her back against him.
Like, oh, yeah, I think... so he is. I actually forgot about that part. Here we go. Here's the quote. That's right, baby. Feel me. All of me. All right, so there's a lot of commas in here. There's no periods at all. Like, not even at the end of it. That's right, comma, baby, comma. Feel me, comma, all of me, comma. Like, or that's right, comma, baby, period. Feel me, period. All of me, period.
I think that would be definitely better.
There you go. There you go.
I'm just saying, like, with periods, it would have, I feel like it would have felt more powerful.
I agree. It just feels like it's going,
For example, you could break it up like this. That's right. Baby, feel me. All of me. So that he's commanding a baby to feel him.
It's your turn, Chad. It's okay. Your turn, Chad.
Oh, no. It's your turn, Cad. So there's a sentence where Anastasia is describing something. I forget what. She says something acute, pleasure slash pain. And there's no reason to put a slash between these because, like, E.L. James occasionally does this. Like, she does that. She did that one time with, moth, flame, bird, snake. And, like, if it were a consistent thought process with Anastasia, like it was an established character trait or just her style of thinking, that would be one thing. But it seems like E.L. James just pulls this out for no apparent reason when she feels
Christian
like it.
Christian does it in this chapter as well when he says that.
Oh, yeah.
What was it? The wrists and or ankles. And slash or ankles. But at the same time, I didn't bring it up in the podcast because I'm not really sure how you would fix that. Because it really is for your ankles or your... And your... Yeah. And or. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, people do say that, even though it's like they just do it to sort of be weird. Like, something and or something. People don't usually say slashes out loud. At least not when they're serious. And again, I'm not saying that this is totally incorrect. I'm just saying that, like, E.L. James, the way that she does it so inconsistently is the problem.
Well, I think that we would all agree that it's not a sign that this was edited, because typically those sorts of things would be removed.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really simple fix. You just say, like, acute pleasure and pain. You just throw a conjunction in there.
Okay, it's time for Americans. So, I want to mention that the two that I picked are not necessarily, like, hard rules here. Okay. The quote is, for the first one, "Shall I make you come this way? Shall I make you come this way?" The way that I test some of these out is that I read it in my head in, like, a southern accent, and there's no way that's happening. Like, "Shall I make you come this way?" Like, I don't think you shall, actually.
I think your other one works just fine with that.
Yeah, it does. The next one is, "Turn round," he whispers. And that one does work, but you still... it's not apostrophe round. It's also not the first time that she says round.
It says turn around in the print version.
Turn round.
So that was something that they definitely felt probably sounded too British, so they changed it.
Well, the one thing that the editors were allowed to change.
Maybe they did it without her knowledge. They just slipped in the A.
Anna says, "Butt plug." They're looking at the contract. "Does it do what it says on the box?" They're not looking at a box, just for clarification. They're looking at the word on a list. I feel like this is obviously that expression of, "Does it do what it says on the tin?" Which is very British. I don't think I've ever heard it in American media.
I don't know if I have either.
In the fan fiction, it is, "Does it do what it says on the package?" I'm not sure why they changed it.
So I think both of these are poor attempts to Americanize that phrase. Because maybe she knows that we don't usually say tin. And so she's like, "Oh, well, but they still have the phrase. So what would they say?"
I think the American way to say that would be to say, "Is that what it sounds like?"
Yeah.
A butt plug?
Does it do what it sounds like it does?
Yeah.
See, we know that. But E.L. James, she's a special case.
I mean, it's not, like, something, I guess, that we have a specific phrase for. It's just, like, a case of they have a specific phrase they would use for that.
Yeah, we don't have an idiomatic phrase for that, so
it's wording now. Yeah,
Yes. Okay. I take a moment to admire the pretty. This is just Anna looking at Christian. And it's I feel like this is too internet-y for Anna, who knows nothing ever. I just don't feel like this is a thing that she would say, other than in a silly girl manner.
I take a moment to admire the ownage.
Or it's like almost like a lolcat kind of thing.
Yeah, it is very much.
It sounds like a really, you can insert so many goony phrases, like these terrible internet person phrases, like, I take a moment to admire the lols, or something like that. Just like awful, awful internetisms.
Yep. Next.
Nothing beats a good Bollinger. How do you say it?
Bollinger?
Bollinger. Nothing beats a good Bollinger. This is what Christian says when he has the champagne bottle in his hand when Anastasia opens the door. And in the next sentence, she's like, ooh, blah, blah, like, no pun intended. And I was kind of like, excuse me? So I read that for a few minutes, and I finally asked my boyfriend, and we realized it's because nothing beats a good Bollinger.
Yep.
Yeah. Like, hits beats, and she's like, oh, like, clever word choice. But there's no stress on the word beats, and like...
Like, yeah, I feel like she's probably going to use, like, any time he says beets, like, in any context. I mean, she did that the same thing when he was talking about having his eggs beaten. Though he was trying to be clever in that case.
But the thing is, however, that nothing beats it. So it's actually not being beaten.
Yeah.
Really hope that at some point he's going to say, I'm a little tied up at the moment. And she's going to be like, how ironic. In the communities I've been to, like, that's an extremely overused joke.
I'm a little tied up at the moment.
And then everybody in the room laughs because it has a secret meaning to us bondage enthusiasts.
Oh my god.
And just to clarify, it's not italicized or anything in the print copy either. So it's just as opaque. Like, I stopped for a second when I was like, is she just saying that because of beat? And I was like, that's the only thing it could be. But so this is apparently Anastasia's sense of humor. She doesn't have a real one. It just, she's like, I recognize that. It's straight up reference humor. She's like, beets, that's like this thing. Haha. She's eating some beets and she's like, oh, just like you, Christian. And then she'd cut it and the beet would bleed and she'd be like, just like me. But no, she wouldn't think that through.
It's you, Chad. You just talked and you don't know it's you.
So here's a phrase that Aunt Anastasia thinks to herself when she's...
Actually, the subconscious says it to her.
Oh, right, yes, it's the subconscious. So Anastasia is still saying it to herself, but in the form of her subconscious. So she's thinking about the contract and whether or not she wants to agree, or, well, whether she's done a good thing by agreeing.
The sentence before that is like, how do I not think? And her subconscious says that. Because he asks her not to think about anything. Yes, that's the context.
So she's saying, like, oh, I can just become an object. But then she tacks on, like, his other possessions. I can pretend to be a car, like his other possessions. So apparently all of Christian's possessions are just pretending to be cars. So, like, are they people? Is Christian's apartment just full of people pretending to be cars, just sputtering around, like, beep beep, and vroom vroom all the time? And Christian's just like, yes, this is the perfect life.
That made me wonder if, like, there was ever some sort of event or perhaps some sort of BDSM installation where they had, like, a whole room and every piece of furniture was a person being objectified.
I was gonna say, is car play a thing?
I feel like there's definitely probably been some sort of, like, human sculpture.
Yeah.
Like, when they've been getting into cars, like Christian's car, have they actually just been climbing onto some guy, like, in his boxers, who's just been, like, vroom, 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 and he's all tired and sweaty, like, walking down the sidewalk with Christian and Anna on his back?
Vroom, vroom, oh, this is great.
So the last possibility is that all of Christian's possessions are self-aware and also sapient, so that they have the capacity to pretend that they're cars, but then why would they do that? Like, his toaster just thinks to itself, today I'm a car.
Today I'm a car. I thought this was great. It's like a very kindergarten insult. And it's also coming from Anastasia herself to insult herself. If you like cars so much, maybe you should pretend to be one. Like, it's like a non. It's really dumb.
That's related to something that I will bring up later, how childish Anastasia is.
Oh, sorry.
Oh.
That's the exact nature of my confusion. Ho, my subconscious mouths at me because she's going to get money or a car or something. Like, the italics and the way it's at the beginning of a sentence, it just makes me think of it as a declarative, you know, just an exclamation, you know, like, ho!
What ho?
Onward. Yeah. What ho? Yeah.
I wish I had seen this when I was reading the text, because then I could have put in a pet theory about her being a reincarnation of Lion-O.
So I asked... I read this with my boyfriend. He didn't understand what this meant. He's not a native English speaker, by the way. At first he was like, what? He thought it was a weird thing for someone to call themselves because it was too ghetto for somebody who doesn't know what a vagina is. And, like, I'm not saying ghetto in a mean way, by the way. Just that ho is not, like, a... it did not come from auspicious cultural elites, I think is what I'm trying to say. Right. Why would you call yourself a ho? Would you not call yourself, like, a whore instead?
A tramp?
Yeah, A-L-C. a tramp, like...
Harlot,
Yeah, harlot, or somebody who, yeah.
A scarlet woman.
A scarlet, a Jezebel. Anyway, it just was inappropriate tone for Anastasia.
This isn't the first time she's done it either.
He grabs me and leads me back into the apartment and straight into the bedroom. No pass and go. I don't feel like this is any sort of expression, like... go might need to be capitalized or in quotes to if they are like trying to reference Monopoly.
I think they are, yeah.
Which I didn't realize was a thing in Britain. Or maybe it's something else? I don't know.
Wait, why wouldn't Monopoly be a thing in Britain? Is this an ignorant question?
It seems like a very American game.
It is very capitalist. Let's see. She says that when they're just rushing to the room, and to me that's not like they don't pass go, they just don't stop on go. You see, when they rolled the dice, they were allowed to go pass go.
They say do not pass go and you go straight to jail, so you still don't pass it to get the money. It's not that you stop there. You just pass it and collect $200.
Oh, that's right. But then why didn't she add do not collect $200? Because then that would have made it clear.
No pass and go, no collecting $200.
Do not collect $200. Do not pass go. That's what the instruction on the card is, I think. But maybe she thinks that she's going to jail, which is great.
Oh, that's bad if she sees her bedroom as jail.
Ah, jail with Christian. Next. Quote. I blink rapidly. No, I don't. I blink rapidly. And my blood pounds around my body, warming places I didn't know existed until very recently. My blood pounds round my body. Okay, well, first of all, she needs to stop with this. I just learned about my vagina stuff. Like, you've had sex enough time. You know what a vagina is. I don't need to know that it didn't know that you didn't know that it didn't exist until recently.
That doesn't even make sense. Like, how could she not know?
Sometimes it doesn't need to make sense. No, but it... I agree. Well, it's kind of like saying that you didn't know that you had a shoulder blade because you can't see it and you never touch it. But surely you know that you have one. Anyways, my real complaint was actually that she says her blood pounds round her body. Like, what's the big idea with round something? Why isn't it around something? And maybe it's different in your version.
Well, let me see. What? I blink rapidly, wearing place to know. What's happening?
I think he's like, let's go have... Fuck. Here we go. Well, I'm glad you've told me. We'll keep canning off the list for now. And as you get more comfortable, blah, blah, blah. He kisses me on the lips. Yeah, okay.
She says my blood pounds through my body.
Okay, so they changed it. Mm. I feel like this only helps my... that thing that I said earlier, that round is kind of too English. I think that's true. And also pounds round, again with like the weird rhyming. It also pounds round sounds like a weird rapper.
My name is Pounds Round, and I'd like to say I like to rap in a vaginal way. First you got the clit, and then there's a split. Inside is the hole. We're ready to roll.
The pussy is my microphone. The pussy is my vacation home.
Excuse me, MC Pounds Round, but this just sounds like a description, not a style. But anyway, here's a line that Anastasia internally monologues right when... So Christian has given over control to her and asked her to undress him, and she has done so. So she's fondling him and watching his expression, and this is what she says to herself. His mouth shapes like a letter O as he takes a sharp breath. That description is very, very childish, and it sort of goes back to like the... pretend to be a car, like all his other possessions. Like, maybe she's just...
I immediately jumped to, like, what would be the most adult way to have that? All I could think of was his mouth puckers.
Why do you need to make a simile like that? I mean,
is that what it's doing? I thought he was, like, opening it really wide.
See, it's unclear because she can't describe anything. It could either be a huge, like, gaping maw, or it could just be, like, a tiny, like, spitting water at somebody hole.
Yeah, she didn't specify capital or lowercase.
Actually, she specifies capital, if Chad's note is to be trusted. A capital italicized O.
But it's also in italics, so...
A
little crooked.
This is related to my pet theory that, like, Anastasia, the goddess inhabiting Anastasia is keeping her developmentally stunted, like a child.
But how long has the goddess really been around? I think that Anastasia is just a stunted child.
So, well, the theory that you put forth was that Christian implanted the goddess, but perhaps the goddess was always there and Christian just awakened it.
Interesting.
And it's just been keeping her, like, at a certain level because she needs that control.
So we're constantly informed about what Anna's hair is doing. Like, it's, you know, where it is at all times. This is weird. Like, it seems like that's something that hasn't been done before, really. Like, he pulls it a little, I guess, or, like, puts it over her shoulder so he can
look.
Yeah,
he scoops it, actually. Once again, he's scooping
yeah,
it.
Yeah, he scoops it around. She, like, we are told, like, you know, her hair, she feels her hair falling against her back as she rears her head back or something. It kind of reminds me of a thing that I do when I write sometimes, which is that I have to constantly know and say where everybody's hands are at all times. Like, I've got to say, oh shit, I have to explain where their hands are, this isn't going to make sense, even though it probably will, and people can just infer what's happening.
But even in a non-erotic situation, or is it only in an erotic situation?
Even in a non-erotic situation sometimes. Like, if I'm something intricate, then yeah, even though it's really not necessary. But this is hair, not a thing that you manipulate things with.
Hair tentacles.
Christian reaches a hand up to my back, and my hair decides it's time to go out to the diner, because it's really hungry.
Next.
Is you.
Sliding my fingers under the waistband, feeling the hair in his oh-so-happy trail. I really hate the phrase happy trail.
Me too.
Possibly because I hated the person I first heard it from. But I think that I still don't like it, even disregarding that.
Looks like you two are hiking on the unhappy trail. It's a good point you bring up. I never really thought about this before, this phrase, happy trail, because, I mean, people use it or whatever, but, like, it is gross. It's weird.
I've also heard it called the treasure trail. Can't we think of a word that isn't...
The Oregon Trail.
Yes, the Oregon Trail, because it's leading to the Oregon.
Yeah, you win the podcast. That's great.
I have to ask, Cherrydoom, was that voice that you put on for Looks Like You Two Were on the Unhappy Trail, was that your impression of Pubie the Bear?
Who?
What?
I just made it up. Never mind. I was trying to think of something that went along with Smokey the Bear.
It was actually an imitation of a voice that I've heard you use.
Oh.
Kind of like you're droopy.
Three, two, four.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't start pube fires.
Try not to start fires.
Only you can prevent oral sex.
The only acceptable fire on the happy trail is the fire of love.
All right, we have one last thing. I feel his grin against my neck as his hands move down to my hips. I guess that you can feel someone's grin. It's just weird.
This is very common, I feel. I mean, in writing, I see it all the time, that someone feels someone smiling against their skin. Usually against their neck, in fact.
I can only imagine it, once again, if there's, like, a little scoff, like, like you feel the breath of it, but...
I mean, I'm assuming she's, like, feeling his lips stretching out, which is...
Weird, yeah. It's weird.
Huh? Yeah, maybe.
But it's I don't know if you'd call it a trope, but it's definitely a cliche, I would say.
Situational! I'll start us off. So in this chapter, they drink a lot. Actually, specifically, Anastasia's the one doing a lot of drinking, because Christian keeps giving her drinks, and I counted these drinks. He serves her 5 teacups of champagne, which she drinks, and there's some tricky language. Like, they'll dwell on the fact that he offers her another, but he doesn't give it to her for, like, a couple sentences. But I'm fairly confident this is the correct number. It's 5 drinks. And I'm sure some of you are like, oh, 5 teacups of something doesn't sound like a lot, but I mean... It's a lot.
I mean, 5 in, like, less than an hour for...
Yeah, that's kind of like a...
It's like a beer equals a glass of wine equals shot.
Yeah, and I suppose champagne would be considered a wine. But here's the thing, like, a champagne flute,
right.
It doesn't... You don't get that much in it.
Right.
Like, compared to a teacup, Like, that's a lot of fucking champagne. Yeah. Even though it says the first cup that he gives her is half of a cup, but that's still... I mean, I have a teacup right here, as a matter of fact. And even half a cup is still, like, a lot of alcohol.
Yeah, this is my safe word, Ellen. I'll talk more about it. But yeah, it seems like a lot. They talk about sex and about how Christian has been pecked. Like, okay, they're talking about anal sex. Okay, let me read this. Oh yes, it'll need careful preparation. Anal intercourse can be very pleasurable, trust me. But if we try it and you don't like it, we don't have to do it again. He grins down at me. I blink up at him. He thinks I'll enjoy it? How does he know it's pleasurable? Have you done that? I whisper. Yes. Holy crap, I gasp. With a man? No, I've never had sex with a man. Not my scene. Mrs. Robinson? Yes. Holy shit. How? I frown. Obviously with a strap on. He says that anal sex can be pleasurable. However, for men, it's a little bit different because of the prostate. That's usually, like, what causes the pleasure. Women don't have that. I've heard that the G-spot can be stimulated from...
the butt, yes.
Inside the anus. From the butt, yeah. That's, see, I'm not sure about that, because that seems like a lot of layers to go through. and I mean, some ladies like anal, but it's very different, I think.
I don't know. I mean, I have no experience.
The way men experience it, just because of the existence of the prostate.
I have no experience with this at all. However, it does seem like some girls like it, like, an awful lot. They're like, I can't get enough of anal. There's not really, like, a standard reaction. Some people like it, some people don't.
Right.
For whatever reason.
Also, like... when he says, have you done that? I whisper. How does... like, they seem to assume that she's talking about being on the bottom, when it seems like... it sounds like he's saying it can be pleasurable for himself, like, doing her in the butt.
Yeah.
It's some weird logic leaps here. I mean, but maybe she's just being really non-assuming.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, when you put this note in the doc, like, I was actually confused because when I read this scene... because he's talking about her receiving it. It kind of sounds like he's trying to convince her that she will like it and that he has not received it, that he has given it. They don't say who pitched and who caught, I mean.
Yeah.
So I had initially read it as him giving it to Mrs. Robinson, not taking it from her. But it makes sense that he would take it from her because he was the sub.
She could have been like, you're my dildo right now, and I'm gonna fuck myself with you, or something like
that.
Yeah,
but...
but maybe I'm just making an assumption, but I feel like that's definitely what's going on.
Seems like Anastasia would be more shocked to learn that Christian was on the bottom, not that he was on the top, because that's not necessarily...
exactly.
Okay. We understand each other.
Okay. We've talked about suspension, and it's fine if you want to set that up as a hard limit. It takes a great deal of time, and I only have you for short periods of time anyway. It doesn't take that long. I mean, she's gonna be with him for 48 hours. Hmm. They'll have plenty of time to do suspension. It's not that big a deal. It's not like she'll be, you know, suspended for half a day, or like it'll take half a day to get up into the ropes. Anyway, it's
does he not mean that it takes a long time to get used to it?
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't think so. And it sounds like he's just like saying, oh, well, it takes a long time, so I don't want to do it either, instead of like just letting her make the decision why she doesn't want to.
From what I've read in this book so far, it seems like neither of them are a fan of like those marathon sessions, because I'm thinking like with certain acts like suspension or bondage, there is that possibility where like you want your subs to be up there for like at least an hour or whatever.
Yeah.
And it doesn't seem like either of them are really interested in that. So that could be what he means.
I mean, a lot of the appeal of rope to rope enthusiasts is like taking their time with it. Doing it really slowly and precisely. So yeah, I guess I can see that. Next.
There is nothing about you that is cheap, Anastasia. I won't have you thinking that. I just bought you some old books that I thought might mean something to you, that's all. Have some champagne. Creepy. But then why is he being such a cock about her giving them back to him if he just bought some old books that he thought might mean something to her? Like, just give her a gift that she'll find hard to refuse.
Like what?
Like a car.
yeah, these fucking books. and yeah, this fucking car. She gets a car and is mad, but eventually she accepts it. I don't know, I just thought we should, since this is like a major plot point of this book, or this chapter,
Well, I mean, I was thinking about this this morning, even, like, how would we feel if we suddenly got a car from a sexy dom?
It depends on your personality.
When I first got a car, I was kind of like, I don't want a car. I mean, now I have to worry about getting in a wreck and insurance and gas. No. But now I love a car, of course.
I agree.
I think that, like, with Anastasia's general characterization as being, you know, resistant and sort of rebellious, like, that's why she's upset at first. She's like, oh, I don't need your charity. But then
she's not really characterized as rebellious, Chad.
Well,
she tries to be.
I'm not saying that is how E.L. James wants her to seem.
All right, now I understand.
Yeah, I'm not saying that that's how she comes across. Yeah, but, like, it's things like this where she just relents immediately that really subvert that.
But we're not talking about Anastasia, even though Anastasia and Chad are the same person. We're talking about Chad. How would you feel if a dom of your orientation, gender, that you're attracted to, gave you a car and insisted that you take it for free?
Well, I think, like, that's all I was trying to say about, like, Anna's personality. I think it depends on the particular person's personality. Like, maybe some people will just be like, yeah, I got a new car. Great. And some people will be like, I don't want you to give me shit like this. It sort of depends on
the situation more. Okay.
Yeah, I think.
I'd say for me, because, like, I was thinking really hard about this because I'm a terrible person. One part of me really wanted to take it because I love free things. I would find it very difficult to reject this kind of relationship because, how personal can I get with this? I chose occupations in life that do not make me a lot of money. If I had somebody who was willing to give me a lot of things, I think I would find it very hard to say no, unless they were also, like, infantilizing me in some way. And I guess that he does kind of do that to her, so if someone was doing this to me, I'd say no.
Yeah, I really don't like feeling like I owe anybody anything. Even if they were to say, oh, you don't owe me anything, I would feel that, like, emotional. I would feel like I was being manipulated, even if I wasn't, just because I'm paranoid like that.
Yeah, I would almost certainly say no.
I think it has to do with, like, how dependent you're comfortable being. And, like, for me, that's more. And for you guys, that's less.
If I could, I would take it and just be like, okay, I don't owe you anything, goodbye.
Yeah, I'd just disappear. I'd just drive off into the sunset, presumably into, like, the ocean and die.
I would probably sell it for money, which is crazy, because if you do that with someone's gift, they probably get really pissed off at you.
Yep.
Okay, here we go. And after she accepts the car, after she gets mad, he says, you are one challenging woman, Anna Steele. And by the way, he kisses her passionately, forcing her lips apart with his tongue, taking no prisoners. She just fucking acquiesced to the car. Like, she's not challenging. She's the opposite of that. She's unchallenging in every way.
I mean, I guess it's because she spent, like, 5 minutes, or less than 5 minutes, like, saying, no! And then, what a challenge.
Also, once again, he kills any possible hostages. I'm assuming her teeth, so all of her teeth are broken. How many lives and teeth are you responsible for, Christian?
His fingers hook into my panties at the back, stretching them, and he pushes his thumbs through the material, shredding them and tossing them in front of me so I can see. Holy shit. I'm not exactly sure how he pulls this off. Okay, he shreds it from the back, but he also shreds the leg holes so that he can...
He just has to, like, completely tear them apart in order to get them off.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah, and, like, how sharp are his... Like, what kind of panty... Like, she must be wearing, like...
I believe it says in the book that she's wearing mesh panties, and I can confirm that they're easy to rip.
Doesn't say that in the print copy at all.
Wait, I'm looking. Mesh. Oh, boy.
Charles does a Google search for mesh.
An hour later, I haven't learned anything. wow, it's not finding the word mesh anywheres. Where did I think that I saw that? Okay, no, he pushes his thumbs through the material, not the mesh.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So they're not.
She doesn't seem like a mesh panty kind of lady, so, like, I feel like these are just, like...
She wore them to her graduation.
Yeah, they must just be, like, cotton or, you know, nice lady satin or the Under Armour, not Under Armour. You know, like the stretchy panty material for regular ladies who don't have a lot of sex.
I don't think that she'd wear, like, her granny panties to graduation.
I'm not saying granny panties, but I'm just saying panties that aren't...
Okay, I don't think that she would wear her chaste Mormon panties. the graduation.
That's not what I'm saying.
I know it's not.
You can have a cotton thong.
Okay, so like the bikini panty is what I'm thinking, which is fairly standard for anybody. But I still say that I don't think that you'd wear that to your graduation if you're anything like me.
What are you wearing to your graduation then?
Like my nice pair, whatever they are.
What are they?
I don't know what to say.
Then what are you...
You want me to get up and...
Do I need to, like, go through all the panty types so I can see what you're saying?
No, okay, well, typically...
Hipster, bikini,
okay, wait,
thong,
just hold up. So if you're wearing a nice dress anyways, and I don't know if this dress is form-fitting or if it has... If it could be seen because it's kind of like a chiffon-y. So you probably wear, like, a nude thong type thing, which... from my experience, are somewhat easy to destroy.
He really fucking just...
I mean, yes, I admit that you have to have some Hulk hands to be doing what he's doing.
He's gotta have some really sharp thumbnails, if nothing else, to get in there initially. He doesn't, like, rip the stitching, he just pushes his thumb straight through.
Yeah, that is the weird part. Like, I think that if a guy grabs it and then, like, you know, separates... then mm-hmm. it will rip. But you can't just, like, push your thumbs through. Like, your thumbs have
got
to be...
It's not like wet tissue paper.
Like, tissue paper.
Yeah. I was wondering, maybe she's just wearing, like, newspapers or something.
my Couture newspaper panties. He rips right through them.
She's just wearing copies of Kate's interview article.
Panty argument.
Oh, boy. Next.
So at the very end of the chapter, when everything is... done. This is what Anastasia thinks to herself. Let's see. He's mine and I'm his. The thought pushes me, weighted with concrete over the edge, and I climax around him, ellipsis, shouting incoherently. So I just pictured Anastasia just sort of babbling nonsense syllables and making, like, noises and grunts, and Christian is just staring at her, horrified and confused.
Yeah, there's a lot of, like, you know, she calls a garbled version of his name. Shouts incoherently.
Actually, I mean, this is creepy. Not during sex, but last night when I was sleeping, my boyfriend woke me up and he was not saying anything. He was just like, yes, it's...
I've been told that I talk in my sleep like that.
I've heard that you talk in your sleep, but I don't know how true it is. Because, yeah, anyways.
I collapse onto his chest, overwhelmed, somewhere between fantasy and reality, a place where there are no hard or soft limits. First, I was like, what the fuck does this mean? This is the line that ends the chapter.
Right.
And you brought up Cherrydoom.
I brought up something called subspace. I think that's what it's called.
Yep, that is what it's called. I totally didn't even...
But she wasn't really being a sub is the thing, so I just...
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. Nonetheless, he does some things that might put her there. Should we explain? Can we explain what that is for people who don't know?
Yes. From what I know, you might be able to explain it better. Subspace is where you just, like, totally get into the fantasy of the BDSM situation. Like,
right. You go to this place in your head where, like, you're the ultimate sub and, like, you'll do... I mean, maybe this is wrong, but, like, you're willing to do anything in order to be the sub.
Yeah, you're very suggestible. You are, you know, very calm.
Yeah.
Maybe not calm, but, like, very...
Right, like, you're in the zone. And then sometimes coming out of that zone... is very overwhelming, and you need, like, aftercare, is what they would say. Just some cuddles and making sure you are emotionally stable and everything.
That doesn't sound like what she's talking about, though.
No, it sort of sounds like she is, like, collapsing into the pages of the book. A place between fantasy and reality, a place where there are no hard or soft limits.
Yeah, what, like, she hasn't mentioned anything about a fantasy during this encounter, so I'm not sure what fantasy
she's talking
about.
I don't really
know
either. I guess maybe the fantasy of maybe she's in, like, dom space, because that's the only thing I can really think of. Because right before she says that,
maybe.
She's like, me, I'm in control. And, like, she comes. So, but she knows that she's not really in control. And so maybe that's what she's referring to. But I just don't know.
I took it to mean that she was sort of, like, it felt like a natural relationship or something.
Yeah, so that fantasy that she...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Because it's a place where there aren't any limits, like... It's the between fantasy and reality is sort of weird, but I think it's just, like, you know, a liminal, like, after orgasm thing.
Okay, yeah, right. So when you're having sex and stuff and you're not discussing all these hard and soft limits, maybe that's what she was referring to. Just, like, the culmination of physicality. I don't know, but this is still bad.
Okay, Kate chat. There's not a lot. She just mentions that she steps out of Kate's shoes. She just always has to...
I'm wearing nothing but Kate's shoes.
Yeah. She always has to, like, remember that she's not wearing her own clothes, and that she's always has a connection to Kate, even when she's boning down. Favorite lines? Oh, shit, I didn't do mine. Oh, well.
So my favorite line is because it's so silly. I'll agree to fisting, but I'd really like to claim your ass, Anastasia.
That's the line. That's the line.
She doesn't react to that. She just says, training, I whisper.
Yeah.
Training.
He follows it up with, like, but you're going to need some training. And she's like, training?
Butt plugs.
I'm going to read my favorite lines. I have a runner-up. But here's my first favorite line is, dread spawns in my belly. Dread spawns in my belly.
That's pretty good.
Judge Dread spawns in my belly. Or... I want to be buried in you, Anastasia. I'm paraphrasing, I don't know, but definitely I want to be buried in you is there. It sounds too literal, like the Anastasia graveyard.
Where Christian keeps all the other clones of her.
Goddess Watch.
The goddess is very childish in this chapter. She, like, jumps up and down, then claps her hands like she's waiting for ice to get ice cream. And Christian is describing all of the things he's going to do to her. She also has the ice cream taken away. I can't remember when.
It's when Christian says he doesn't want to orgasm.
She's sucking him off, and then the goddess has her ice cream taken away. The ice cream is Christian's cock.
By the way, continuity. Anastasia calls it a Christian, his cock. A Christian-flavored popsicle in the first chapter that she gives him head.
What if this is some sort of weird Frosty the Snowman thing, and he's gonna melt?
Oh no.
Soon.
That's not erotic. The dick gets smaller and smaller the more you manipulate it.
Hey, some people like that, I guess.
Yeah, okay, I guess some people do. But I'm just saying from, like, a practical standpoint. Right. Yeah.
The subconscious hides behind the couch. An actual couch? Or an imaginary couch? Okay, so... My subconscious runs, screaming, and hides behind the couch at the mention of probably a butt plug again. Then later, my subconscious peeks out from behind the couch, still registering shock on her harpy face.
That's when he agrees to the relationship.
Right. And then my subconscious is behind the sofa again, head hidden under her hands. Is this the sofa that's in the room with them, or is it a sofa in Anastasia's brain, in a living room in her brain? Where her subconscious and her inner goddess are an odd couple roommates.
They just live in a living room that they can't escape from.
It's the waiting room of Anastasia's mind, where all of, like, the personalities hanging out there just wait for their turn.
I have a quote. My inner goddess roars, and from somewhere born of frustration, need, and sheer steel bravery, I push him onto the bed. I don't know, she's both childlike and terrifying in this chapter.
Yeah, I wonder what that roar sounds like.
That's a good question.
I mean, it might be, you know, a Katy Perry roar, or an I Am Woman Hear Me Roar type of thing. Or it might just be like a big bear roar.
Or maybe like a little kid doing a dinosaur roar.
Roar!
Exactly. And she's like doing the little dinosaur hands to herself, like really self-amused.
Roar!
One of the last things said about the goddess is, my inner goddess is going to explode, like in Neo-Tokyo. The inner goddess is extremely active this chapter, and apparently she's reactive to pleasure, like lust, fulfillment, and control. All of these things apparently make her more likely to explode, and so this is why I thought maybe she's like a Roman goddess, maybe she destroyed Pompeii, like there was just too much screwing going on, and
was
so...
Was it Pompeii in Greece?
It's in Italy. It's in Naples, like south of Naples on a...
Dumb.
So perhaps she's like some sort of volcano or a goddess of a volcano. And maybe she's going nuclear. We did have that thing about how she could light up all of Portland. Maybe now she's starting to melt down.
Uh-oh.
I think...
It's becoming unstable.
Yeah, I think this is like a true danger to all of us. So I vote that we raise the level.
Okay, I agree.
Raise the level.
What are we raising it
but
to?
I think that it should be a phrase that both describes her childishness... and her volcanicness. And all I could think of was, like, one of those kids at Pompeii, which is an ashy corpse.
Oh, no.
Oh, no. Ashy corpse kid gray.
Ashy Pompeii corpse kid gray.
Good luck, D-Vec.
I was going to say lumpy playroom couch gray, but the corpse one is so good.
Okay, so the next section is what was good, but really, I didn't like anything about the chapter. And I'm surprised that I didn't, because usually I have something, but this time I'm doing a Chad.
Looks like Chad is also doing a Chad.
This chapter was sort of like the previous chapter in which not much happened. Like, she got the car, and then they had sex, and then they kind of talked about the limits. It was actually sort of straightforward. Like, there wasn't too much to really criticize or, you know, like about it. So it was pretty nondescript in my opinion.
Let's see. I guess it's sort of okay that Christian lets her be in control. But, I don't know, it seems like maybe it's only like this is her last hurrah before she's a sub forever. Maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe.
So maybe it's only like so that she can see that she likes it so that he can take it away from her.
Or to like earn her trust.
Yeah. Another good thing is that we're over halfway through this book, guys.
Hey, that is a good thing. I love that about this chapter.
Hooray!
Yay!
Hooray.
Of course, then that brings up the uncomfortable discussion of whether we're doing the other two books, but let's leave that for later.
Right.
Safer time. Christian insists that Anna can work up to caning, even though she right away says that she doesn't want to be caned. Can you please not try to push someone to compromise when they say it's a hard limit? Like,
he's very much like, we can do this, or, you know, he keeps making like little adjustments so that they suit him.
Yeah, I hate it. I mean, like
about like saying that, like, oh, we don't have enough time for suspension, I don't want to do that anyway, or, you know, we'll work up to it.
Yeah, see, the thing that makes me the most angriest about any dom, a fictional dom or a real life dom, is when they can't control themselves. Like, how are you going to control a sub if you can't even control yourself?
Yep, that was like the first part of the mentor program that I went to, was we had to learn to dom ourselves before we could dom other people.
Yeah, it's really important.
And it was the most boring part because I had to do a bunch of introspection, which I do not enjoy.
Oh.
But I agree that it is a good thing to do. This whole thing was really weird and creepy. With the champagne, he kept giving her champagne, and I don't know how to feel about it. Like, it's, you know, me and my not drinking at all, ever. Maybe I just don't know how this works, but Anna and Christian admit that it's affecting her mood or something, and making her quote-unquote braver, as Christian says. He's like, you should drink more, you're getting braver. He definitely seems to be pushing it on her, though she's taking it willingly, and I don't know, it's just, it makes me uncomfortable.
Yes, fair enough.
Yeah, I didn't put anything down because I had the same thing as you, Cherrydoom. It really makes me uncomfortable too, because it seems pretty obvious to me that he's just like feeding her alcohol.
And I mean, she doesn't act drunk after they stop drinking.
Yeah, that's weird.
But...
Well, and the other thing is that, like, she's cognizant of it. She mentions, like, oh, is he trying to get me tipsy? And then she doesn't, like, stop herself. She doesn't...
Yeah.
Despite all of the times that she's, like, gotten into bad situations with alcohol, well, the one time, she still hasn't, like, curtailed her drinking very hard.
Hasn't learned her lesson. No.
But does anybody ever... Everybody drinks... Not everybody, but, you know, like, people never... It seems like they learn... huge generalization... But I mean, you know, people are like, oh, I'll never drink again. You know, that kind of thing.
Well, like, I drink very, very rarely. Like, I don't really like to drink.
It's the same
but
with
when I do, I drink, like, one drink for the entire night over the course of, like, hours.
I would classify myself as someone who's learned their lesson. But a special situation for me because, as was mentioned in this podcast, my body size is not considerable. So that... has led to very dangerous situations in the past, but that's only because one tries to keep up with their companions when they are out doing fun things, and that's not always a wise thing to do, for sure. And that's kind of what led me to stop doing it regularly, even at parties or whatever. I typically don't drink. If I do it, I just do it at home, like, you know, a bit sometimes.
But yeah, I don't know how to take this. I mean, there's like a huge, not huge, there's like a movement now, like saying, you know, all drunk sex is non-consensual sex. And I'm not, it's hard for me to, it seems so prevalent, like people, it seems like that's what people do, they get drunk and they fuck, like.
At least at parties.
At parties and, you know, bars and stuff, perhaps, one night stands and the club, so and so on. It's strange to me, like, there's this movement, but it's so prevalent and people have no problem with it. I don't know. How many more times can I say that I don't know?
See, it's hard because, like, if you hang out, if you're, like, perhaps me and maybe Cherrydoom is like this too, and you hang out on Tumblr a lot.
Yep, that's what I'm talking about, basically.
You get exposed to a lot of this, like, Tumblr morality where it's like, okay, this is always wrong, this is never right, but you have to allow that some people want to make that decision and want to consent to that kind of thing. And I think it's happened, and I think it will continue to happen. I mean, there's I think that it's great that you should always try to avoid the situation where it is ambiguous or can turn into rape. But then there are also those situations where, like, you're really feeling it and you do it. Not that I know from experience, but, like,
Would this possibly count as one of those situations where Anna is willingly drinking to make herself more brave?
Sort of, because she accepts it before she is drunk. And she says to herself, Christian is doing this to me. All right.
Yeah, I guess.
I don't know either.
but I can talk more about it if we go into the spoiler dungeon.
Okay. Does Anna get to take control again like this?
Sort of, yeah.
Okay, well, that's good.
Yeah, I guess I won't describe the particulars.
It's not necessarily, you know, I mean, if you want to, it's not bad if she doesn't, but I mean, if she wants to, then it's good that she gets to.
Yeah. I don't know if she really, I don't know. I'm not going to describe, because, like, I say too much of the spoiler dungeons. I should really only do a basic type spoiler rather than saying the whole thing.
I don't know.
It depends on what the viewers want, so tell me what you want, guys. Our fucking listeners, not viewers. Right, so, okay, fine, I will describe then. Skip it if you don't want to hear it. She wants to work up to touching him. So they do some stuff with that where arguably she is in control, although he is also, because he, like, outlines the boundaries of where it's okay. But, I mean, that's the same as any sort of relationship. You outline the boundaries. Right, so it works up to that. There are a couple little situations like that. I would never say it ever goes into full-blown doming, ever. Because it doesn't. And I have my own spoiler dungeon comment, not really a question. Wait for next chapter for the reasoning behind Christian funneling champagne down Anna's throat, because you get a reason. And see how you feel about it. I'm not going to say what it is, because it'll be obvious in the podcast. Just teasing you.
A little scared. Okay.
Denying you from satisfaction in the spoiler dungeon, where I am the Dom. I guess that's it for the podcast.
Yeah, send us stuff. We should probably think about doing a meta episode pretty soon.
Yeah, I would deeply like to. We're on 15, and I kind of said I wanted 15 or 17 to be the point where we did it. All right, so what is it? Holycastsofreakingpod@gmail.com?
Well...
.com?
.com. It's not a fish-based web service.
.cod.
I mean, if people, when they hear to ask questions, we'll probably have already recorded the meta episode.
That's quite possible. All right, well, anyways, if you send a question, we will answer them in a future episode.
All right, laters,
bye
baby.
Now, then. Goodbye. Laters, babies.